right, so obviously, conference call, we just want to make sure we speak up, you know, particularly you guys, I know there's the mics.
This is Emmerich, can you hear me?
Oh, we hear you very loud and clear, sir.
Okay. Great, Tamara, are we ready to go? I'm having trouble hearing folks in the room.
Yes, sir, we're turning the volume up now, can you hear me now, sir?
I can hear you loud and clear.
Probably too loud, right, sir?
That is sounding great.
Okay, all right, well, we'll go ahead and get started, appreciate everyone for coming today. And thank you for taking the time in Memorial Day week to come talk to us about the submarine fleet and the fantastic men and women we have here. Hi, who joined us on the line, please? Okay.
This is Chip here. Sorry about that, Chip.
Okay. Yes, sir. On the phone, Admiral, we have Virginia Pilot, the Union Tribune, and we have the AP. In the room here today, we have CNN, we have ABC, both national and DC local. We have Stars and Stripes, and we have Navy Times. Did I forget anyone? Nope. Okay. On the phone, obviously, for you all, we have Admiral Richardson. He was not able to come up today because of recent events and last night's fire on board USS Miami. So again, Admiral, thank you for joining us on the phone. We'll share what we can. The Admiral will take what questions that he can answer. If you have anything more specific, please see me, and I can help facilitate that information for you. But more importantly, we have some really fantastic folks with us today, and they've got some amazing stories to be able to share about their experiences in the submarine fleet. So we'd like to be able to focus on that. And again, anything beyond that, you can come see me when we're finished here. This is an on-the-record conversation. We are recording it, so if you have any questions, we can help facilitate that when we're finished. You can see me or call Chinfo afterward. And everyone will get one question and one follow-up, and I will help facilitate that. And then once we are sure everyone has had their turn, we can go through again. I would ask, because the Admiral's on the phone, if you could identify yourself when you are asking a question so he knows who he's talking to. And for those on the panel here today, if you could just identify yourself as you're answering questions so those reporters on the phone know who they're hearing from today. The Admiral will make some brief opening remarks and then we'll turn it over to questions. Is there any questions from any of the reporters? Nope. Any questions from the panel? Nope. All right. We'll go about 30 minutes. I'll give a last question and then we'll go from there and do some breakout sessions. So, Admiral, with that, I'll turn it over to you, sir.
Okay, thanks, Tamara, and thank you all for joining again, as Tamara said, on a Memorial Day weekend. And as she said, originally I planned to join you personally today, but to just provide some opening context for this event. But last night events changed those plans. I had to remain here in headquarters. But I at least wanted to call in and provide a few remarks prior to y'all engaging the submariners that you have before you, which is really the reason that we're here. I wanted to start today, as you're all aware, shortly before 6 p.m. last night, the fast attack submarine USS Miami experienced a fire in the ship's forward compartment. And I wanted to open my remarks by just recognizing that and providing a few details. First, I wanted to start by thanking and providing my respects to all the emergency responders that responded to the fire. There was a terrific team that formed between the ship's crew, the Portsmouth Naval Shipyard Fire Department, and particularly the Seacoast Community Fire Departments and other agency teams that all came together and by virtue of their training and teamwork responded to the fire and put it out. And by virtue of that skill, we're thankful that there were no severe injuries to anybody last night. And we got the best possible outcome. Just a few details. USS Miami is in her third month of a 20-month maintenance period up there at Portsmouth Naval Shipyard. And as I said, it was in the evening last night, just before 6, that the ship experienced a fire in the forward compartment. The Portsmouth Naval Shipyard Fire Department and ship's crew, along with the mutual assistance of many of the Seacoast Community Fire Departments and other agency teams, responded and successfully extinguished the fire on Miami. The fire and the subsequent damage was confined to the four compartment spaces only. Those spaces include crew living spaces, command and control. control spaces in the torpedo room. Torpedo room was empty. In fact, there were no torpedoes or any weapons on board the ship. The nuclear propulsion spaces were physically isolated from the forward compartment early in the initial response and were unaffected by the fire. The propulsion spaces remained habitable and were continuously manned throughout the event. The reactor on the ship had been shut down for over 2 months, and it remained in a stable and safe condition throughout the event. The fire did spread to spaces within the submarine that were very difficult to access, presenting a challenging situation for initial responders. So the combination of difficult access and then the fact that the ship's steel hull, contains that heat, created some very challenging conditions. But the team persevered and demonstrated some real fortitude and resilience to gain control and extinguish the fire. And so it was really by virtue of their heroic actions that they stabilized the situation, protecting the crew and the shipyard workers. There are a lot of heroes that worked together last night to bring this under control, from the Navy, the shipyard firefighters, and the entire seacoast. So a full investigation, as you can imagine, will be done. It's already begun to determine the cause of the fire. This investigation will be very thorough, and by virtue of that thoroughness, it will take some time, but we'll do everything we need to do to get that right. So again, kind of recapping and closing out my remarks on the fire on USS Miami, close as I opened by expressing deep gratitude for the strong support we received from everybody who responded, particularly the state and local partners who have assisted us without the event. We train vigorously, hand in hand, shoulder to shoulder, over years to respond to crises like this, casualties of this nature, and that training was key to success last night. So what I'd like to do, having opened with that, is just kind of return to my original intent, which was to sort of tee up this conversation that we want to have with the young submariners that are before you. I think that there's a growing awareness in the country right now and in our leadership that America is indeed a maritime nation. We're celebrating the 200th anniversary of the War of 1812, which is in many ways a celebration of that, that maritime quality to our nation. It really is in our DNA. And here in the 21st century, to be a maritime nation means that you've got to be superior in the undersea domain as well, even dominant. And our CNO has challenged our Navy to do exactly that in his sailing directions and in his navigation plan, to continue to be dominant in the undersea domain. Myself, together with Submarine Force leadership, took up that call and issued the Design for Undersea Warfare, which organizes our efforts along three vectors. One is, our reason for existing is to provide capable forces to operate and warfight. And so that's our prime directive. We also have an effort to make sure that we provide those ready forces to the forward commanders so that we can, man, train, equip, certify, organize those forces. And we want to do all of those things, provide the forces, operate, and fight those forces if necessary, both now and into the future. The key to doing that, our strongest and most powerful advantage is our people. And the Navy and the Submarine Force really garner the very best people that the nation has to offer. They come from every corner of America, and we are proud of the diversity and the talent that we have in the Submarine Force. And as a step forward in that diversity and opening up doors to more diversity and more talent, we've recently opened the Submarine Force to women, and that's really the opportunity that brings us together today, is to sort of recognize and highlight what I think is a very successful program of integrating women into the Submarine Force. And so here on the eve of Memorial Day weekend, I thought there'd be no better time, since the gathered there in Washington, D.C. to recognize Memorial Day anyway, that it would be an opportunity for us all to get together with you and maybe just give you an opportunity to talk to our young warriors there and see what's on their minds. So with that, I'd like to turn it over to them and see what they've got to say. Thanks very much.
So who wants to volunteer first and tell me what it's like to actually live on a submarine? Very basic question, but in terms of the gender changes that we've been talking about for the last 2 years.
I'll talk about it. I'll start off. This is Lieutenant Strobel from the USS Wildwing Group. I actually had the opportunity to
phone
do...
are having trouble, but I can't hear.
We're having trouble hearing now.
Wondering.
Is that better? Can you hear me if I talk louder like this, ma'am?
Not much.
Not really.
Try the microphone.
Try this.
How's that right there?
Perfect.
Better.
Thank you.
Okay.
Better, thanks.
Oh.
So I had the opportunity to go on one deployment right before we got women, and then a second one when we had women. And there wasn't much of a difference. It was a very smooth transition because we trained and we basically, that big thing was the head situation, which really wasn't that big of a deal because it's already been done on surface ships, so we just took their model, put it on our submarine. And, you know, I thought that when women would come on, it would take up some of my head time, like when I'd be in the shower, but really I think it took up more of theirs because I'd see them asking, oh, is the head free for one of us? So, as far as being a male on a submarine, it really wasn't much of a change at all, to be honest with you.
Can I ask your wife here? Lieutenant J.G. Strobel for her.
This is Lieutenant Tabitha Strobel. I would agree. I think that the transition for us, you know, we came onto the submarine, so we didn't really get an experience of what it was like before, but it was very comfortable, and we felt very comfortable in our room, and I think it took a little bit for the crew to get used to, you know, coming to knock on our door. Sometimes we'd leave our room and we'd see someone standing there waiting to talk to us instead of just knocking on the door. But it definitely became more and more comfortable as the deployment went on. But I agree, it was a really good transition.
There were concerns that were tossed around. Now that, you know, you've been assigned submarines and you've gone out, what are some of the challenges that you have faced? Because there's, with any new situation, there has to be challenges. I mean, there's got to be something that, you know, was an adjustment. It's a completely different environment than you've ever been in before. I'm assuming there's something you can add.
Oh. Hi, it's Lieutenant J.G. Abigail Holt from the USS Wyoming Blue. I think I can speak for most of the girls because we all know each other from going through the pipeline. It's a challenge to be a junior officer on a submarine in general. And so outside of being female on a submarine, like all of us are trying to qualify, all of us are trying to support the wardroom and be a team member. And that is challenging in itself. It's challenging, excuse me, like going underway with the submarine and being apart from your family for extended periods of time. And so some of us have experienced a small part of that, but it's just been a challenge in general, trying to become a member of the submarine force and be a team player. So.
Excellent. What about because I personally have claustrophobia, and I wonder about the space constraints being on the submarine. What's that been like for you?
Well, on our submarine, there's three women and there's a three-man stateroom, three-person stateroom, excuse me, which is probably one of the biggest rooms of the stateroom. So we got really lucky with that, and we have a good amount of space for ourselves. And honestly, it wasn't really an issue. I don't know if it's just because we're on boomers and they're pretty large to begin with, but you know, I did some summer cruises on destroyers and an LSD, and it really doesn't feel much smaller than the surface ships that I've spent time on, really. So I don't know if anybody else has any opinion on that. But.
You guys are being shy.
Yeah.
Come on. You're much more talkative in there.
Lieutenant Kolchitsky.
Just ask for just some general background information. The total number of women in the pipeline, like attending the submarine officer basic course, just where does the whole program stand now? Thank you.
Admiral, sir, you want to take that?
This is Commander Ruslo. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can, ma'am.
Yeah, I'm trying to figure out how to work this phone. Okay, so we have 24 females that have already reported to the submarines, and those are the SSBNs and the SSGNs. And our next phase of the integration will take place in January of 2013. We have 10 women who are graduating from the submarine officer basic course in June of 2012. And they'll start the prototype in around August. They're scheduled right now to graduate around January of 2013. And then we'll, you know, shortly after that, report to their submarines. And then we have
by this time next year, we're talking about there'll be 34. I don't know what the prototype means. I'm sorry.
Let me just step in here, Admiral Richardson. So just in general, to execute the plan, we're assessing roughly 20 women per class per year. And there's about a little bit over a year, maybe 15 to 18 month training program from the time you graduate from your college and start the program. It's about, you know, 15 to 18 months of training before you report to your first ship. And so, you know, and those classes can be sort of spread in a number of different classes that are, that training pipeline is executed by taking a number of different classes that are spread throughout, you know, that 18 months. So roughly, you know, we're assessing about 20 per year, and so you should sort of see roughly, again, 20 per year reporting to their submarines every year after this one. Does that help you?
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Adam, you had something to say?
Yes, ma'am. All right, touching on the, first off, this is Lieutenant Kolchitsky, USS Maine. Touching on the question of claustrophobia, being a little bit larger than the average submariner, I find it's a lot roomier than I had expected. I had gone on the VIP trip for when I did the NUPOC and got picked up that way, and I had walked through, had a hard hat on, which added a little bit more height, and was really uncomfortable with being on the sub, but after I was underway for just 12 days or a little bit more than that, and in that short time you learn to where you can stand, where you can't, and you realize there's a lot more space, and if you find there's spots that you can find your own little personal space and get your work done or study, but along that line you also have to be very comfortable being close to somebody else because you're standing shoulder to shoulder with them often, so it's just an adjustment.
I was
assigned to one of the bunk rooms, and it's about the size of one of these tables is the center area, and not the whole thing, just one of the three sections. And your rack is about the size of, say, a small coffin. I'd assume. I've never actually laid inside a coffin. But overall, I was comfortable, and you're doing so much work all the time. For me, I didn't have a division yet, so I was just working on my qualifications. For others, they're staying up late, working with divisional paperwork, then doing qualifications, and you're trying to fit in maybe a workout here and there. And so you, by the time you hit the bed or the rack, you are ready to fall asleep instantly. And you know, I tried reading a book once, and I think I woke up the next morning and found it on the floor next to where I was sleeping. So you're so tired, you just fall right asleep.
Hey, this is Admiral Richardson again. For any of the reporters, we're happy to bring you down on board any of the submarines and tour you around, and you get to see firsthand kind of the dimensions that we're talking about, okay?
Great. Lieutenant, you know, you've been on a surface ship, and a lot of people have probably done ship tours. Can you, you know, maybe give some comparisons there?
Yes. Lieutenant Esch, I'm on the USS Ohio Blue. So I was on a destroyer, and the submarine that we're on is actually a few feet longer than the destroyer was. So that gives you an idea that it's really not much different. And a lot of the spaces in the submarine are more roomy than they were on the surface ship. My stateroom on my ship was a three-man, and my stateroom on the submarine is also three-man. And really, the living space is about the same in both of them. I do have one story, though. When I first got to the submarine, I was doing my check-in with my my sea dad, as they call them. He's a qualified submariner. And he had the rack that I was going into, and he said the most important things are, one, you bring a big blanket because the fan is right above it, and that top rack is very cold. So that was the most important thing. And then the other one was, he was the electrical officer, and I was taking his job as the electrical officer. So as that division officer role, we're responsible for being the phone talker for the XO during fire drills. And so he said, although you normally lay in one direction, I'd recommend laying the opposite way because I found it really easy to swing off of this one pipe above the rack and get out of that really fast whenever there's a fire drill. So those are my moving in experiences on the submarine. So, yeah.
Sam Foman from Navy Times. How are you doing in your qualification process? I mean, you've been aboard for 4 to 6 months, so tell us about that, please.
I'll take that one. Lieutenant Mayor, USS Wyoming Blue. Was here before the integration, here after the integration, and my role on the submarine now is the senior JO, per se, and it's been a really interesting because now, as a senior JO, one of your main job is to train the newly reporting JOs on board, and they have the experience to train the new female, the first wave of female officers is awesome to teach the and train on the legacy, the responsibility, and just the extreme hard work it takes to be successful as a junior officer. Is great. And I can say from my perspective on USS Wyoming that the first wave of female officers have been fantastic, and just they're giving us a run for our money. I mean, us as the rest of the JO is not just male, so very smart, and just being in charge of training, I know that they've been very, they're hitting the ground running pretty hard. So to be able to teach the awesome responsibility to drive a submarine when they get qualified and get their fish, be responsible for over the captain's direct representative and be responsible for over at one time maybe over 150 lives, a nuclear reactor, nuclear weapons and torpedoes. That's the ultimate responsibility, and it's awesome. And to be able to get to train these junior officers is in the first wave to be a part of it is awesome. So, not to answer
I'm
that
sorry.
For you guys.
Can you please identify yourself again? I missed your name. I apologize.
Lieutenant Max Mayer, USS Wyoming.
Yes, ma'am. I came to Maine in November, and I have been there so approximately 6 months, and I can say that the training is intensive and extremely rewarding, that our boat, Lieutenant Kolchitsky and I are on the same crew, that our chain of command aggressively pursued our qualifications, that the number one goal for all junior officers is to qualify both expeditiously, but obviously with the highest level of skill and knowledge. And I can personally say that I was given every opportunity to qualify, and every single person on the boat, from someone who had reported after me to the XO and captain themselves, were eager to train us, to teach us, and to give us opportunities to ask questions and to perform at watch standing.
Lieutenant Strobel?
I also reported to the USS Georgia in November, and I completely agree. I think that so far the qualification process has been rigorous. but it's also been a lot of fun, and that's the best part. At the end of the day, what we want to do is drive the submarine, and the chances that we get to do that are extremely rewarding and definitely a lot of fun. So it's been difficult, but I look forward to, you know, continuing the process and one day qualifying fish.
Lieutenant Matter,
yes, ma'am.
Talk about getting to the ship, getting to the submarine, you know, just starting your qualification process.
This is Lieutenant Joshua Matter on the USS Ohio Gold. Qualifications is the same for both of us. It's very difficult, but Ms. Martindale said it's very rewarding as well. We're about to be the direct representative of our captain at times when we're driving the boat. He's ultimately responsible, but we're going to be the ones giving actions and making decisions along with him. So this qualification process is designed to make us ready for that situation when we're standing watch, driving as officer of the deck, standing engine off the watch back aft for the engine room. All these things are getting us ready for what we want to do and what we signed up for, and it's very exciting. We're doing it together. All the JOs are one big family, we're one big group. We're all trying to qualify the same thing to do the same job, and I'm enjoying every bit of it as much as everyone else is.
What's your job on the submarine?
My job on the submarine is the reactor controls assistant. I am the division officer for the division that is in charge of all the reactor safety equipment in the engine room. So.
Sam, do you have a follow-up?
Sure. For those who are following the women in this room, the next class and the class on, what would you tell them the important takeaways from your experience are, like having a mentoring group or getting through this, obviously this academically, probably the Navy's most academically challenging training pipeline. What would you tell them?
I'll take this one, if you want to pass the Good afternoon, I'm Lieutenant J.G. Lorenis. I'm the supply officer on the USS Wyoming Blue. We've actually had some reach out from women at the Academy that have asked us questions that have been selected for the submarine program, or selected to go submarines. So we've been able to let them know, you know, what we're going through now. Some of them didn't know, just you know, just questions, just general questions about school, what the living, where you were living on the submarine, you know, how many people were there, just general questions. And we were easily able to address those, and I think it helped them a lot. And we're still in communication with a lot of those women that have reached out to us. So.
And is that correct? I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I was just gonna, Lieutenant Britta Christensen, USS Ohio Gold. I was just gonna add, like, for my two ensigns, they aren't here right now, they're back on the boat. But whenever we're on the boat and we're training, because we're training, studying, standing watch, everything, people get kind of, sometimes you get down in the dumps or you think, oh my God, this is so hard, I have so much to do. But then when you hear the claxon go off, that's the alarm you sound before you dive the ship. And then you dive the ship, and then that's the time to think, oh my God, I'm on a submarine, this is so cool. Or like for the chops, we stand dive, that's like our big watch. We won't ever stand off through the deck like this, all of the nukes will. So we control the depth of the ship and stuff like that for them while they're driving in directions. So when we can do angles and dangles, like taking 25 degrees ups and downs and stuff, that's when it's cool. Like stuff's flying everywhere because people didn't stow it correctly. But you're like, holy cow, look at what I'm doing. You're like standing like this, but you're standing up. It's pretty crazy. So you got to remember the things like that that make it so awesome, things that people would pay millions of dollars just to experience once, and we get to do it for our job.
Lieutenant Beth Rachel, USS Wyoming. A follow-on, sir, when you'd ask what advice would I give women, I don't think the advice that I would give women would be any different than the advice I give males. In fact, I reached out, I was an academy grad, and some graduates that were selected for submarines after me contacted me, hey, what's it like in power school, and what should I expect? What routine worked for you? And they were males. And it's just a matter of you're a submariner in the pipeline. As far as mentorship, not to detract from the efforts that have been put in place to ensure that we have senior females on board to provide that mentorship capability, I think I've had just as much mentorship from the male members of the ship. And that's important that we recognize that, because it's not, the integration of women is only gonna be for a certain finite period until it's just the submariners on a boat. And it's not gonna be about females getting mentorship from females or males mentoring males. It's gonna be about the longevity of the program and incorporating a junior, senior officer development. So I don't think I would say anything different to a female or a male. It would be, just as Lieutenant Esch said, bring a blanket, be ready to move quick, be ready to put in a lot of long hours, regardless of gender.
I'd like to go, Jen Steele from the Union Tribune, do you have any questions for the group?
I do. Out here we have the very large submarine.
Matt, just ask her to speak up.
Jen, we're having trouble hearing you, Jen. Can you please speak up a little?
Sorry, I'm cold. So we have the snug fast attack submarines out here, and my question possibly for Admiral Richardson is, what are the plans to possibly integrate women on those?
Yeah, so this is Admiral Richardson. We're giving that every consideration. I think that one of the main elements of, we want to proceed, very deliberately. We take great pride in the program that we have right now. The pace and the tone and everything of the program is just the way we want it. I credit all the success for that to folks like the team that you're hearing from right down in the room. As we expand it, there's a number of considerations. There's community management considerations, there's configuration considerations, and then there's also, we want the benefit of the experience of our initial steps. And so now, these teams that are the integrated teams that you're talking to right now are coming back really from their first 6 months at sea, and we want to make sure that we've learned everything that we can from these initial steps before we take an additional step to expand the program to SSNs. Does that answer your question?
What do you think that means time-wise, Admiral?
Well, I think that we're going to move as briskly as we can. Okay, I hesitate to put an exact length of time or a date on it, but I think it won't be too long before we have at least the full ARCI, the full situation mapped out, all of the elements of the discussion, and at that point we can come forward. And make a recommendation to the CNO regarding expansion of the program.
Let me just clarify. It sounds like almost like you're saying it's going to be a go at some point to put women on fast attack. Is that right, or is that one step too far?
I would say it's just premature. We want to open this opportunity as widely as we can, but we want to make sure that it's sustainable. And so I just want to make sure that I understand the decision space as completely as possible so that when I make a recommendation to the CNO, I can back that recommendation up and we'll be standing on firm ground. And so I would characterize my approach to this as we want to open this up as widely as we can as long as it's a sustainable program.
Pauline, did you have a question?
This is Kate Wiltrout, and I wanted to follow up. So far, we're talking solely about women officers. Are there any plans in the works to have enlisted submariner positions open to women?
Yeah, Kate, the exact same answer, really. So that would be an expansion in another direction. And again, we just want to make sure that we understand the decision space before we make any recommendations.
Tamara, can I ask a question?
Sure, absolutely.
If I could use one more question, I wanted to ask this to Lieutenant Christensen. Is she there, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. She is, yes.
I saw in your bio that you were an NFO with the Hawkins Supply Corps, so I was just going to ask you a little bit to contrast what it's like being a submarine versus on carriers and aircraft and in the
deployment? Well, when I was at E2 NFO, my squadron got back from deployment and when I got there, and then I transferred, so I never served on a carrier, but being in the squadron, I was one of few females there, and they just treated me like one of the guys there. When I was on my DDG as the suppo there, the supply officer on board, I was a senior female on board. We had female enlisted, of course, but like Vanessa said, the DDG is a lot like the submarine. It's just as big. I was surprised when I got on board, actually, that it was so big. And my stateroom on the submarine was bigger than my one on my DDG. At first, the guys were a little more timid just because they hadn't worked with us or worked with females on a day-to-day basis, but you know, after a week they warmed up and we were just like brothers and sisters fighting for the bathroom to get in the morning. So you know, it's we're all sailors. If I'm on a surface ship or a submarine, I'm still just trying to sustain that ship, getting them parts and food to do the mission.
ABC has a question.
This is for the Admiral. Can you hear me, sir?
I can hear you.
Excellent. You mentioned lessons learned about this ongoing program. Can you describe what some of those lessons learned are right now, sir?
Well, we're still just gathering them. So, you know, the team is really just getting enough sea time and experience that we, you know, are just getting the lessons. So, you know, they've been on board really since last November or December. And, you know, you take your normal sort of seashore rotation inside of that. And so we're just really kind of getting to the point where we can start to have that conversation. We're getting all the feedback that we can. So far, it's been very positive and very encouraging. And so, you know, I think the lesson that we've got so far is that the tenets of the program, sort of the elements of the program that we put together, seem to be working pretty well. And so if we were going to expand it, we want to make sure that we preserve that same approach, you know, if we wanted to open it up to SSNs, for instance.
CNN?
Hi, this is Lindy calling, or Lindy from CNN. I just had a quick follow-up on the USS Miami. I'm wondering if there were any additional radioactive exposure monitoring that was being done that's in addition to what's normally on a nuclear sub for those people on board when the fire broke out last night.
Yeah, I'm going to ask that you just sort of keep that question, and then, you know, the team up in Portsmouth is better suited to answer those sorts of specific questions. And of course, you know, a lot of those details are also best answered after the investigation.
Thank you.
Do you have a follow-up? Sorry, at all? Okay. Stars and Stripes?
Hi, Jennifer from Stars and Stripes. I just had a question. I know most, if not all, of the women joined the Navy before you knew you were going to be able to be on a submarine. I was just wondering if one or more of you could talk about, you know, why you decided to do the sub program and, you know, hopefully why it's great, but why you decided to do that versus whatever you were doing before.
I can answer that. This is Lieutenant Rebecca Dreeman, USS Maine Blue. I was in Afghanistan when they finally opened up women in submarines, and I jumped at it. I've been wanting to do submarines since I was an ensign when I first joined the Navy in 2006. They told me I couldn't because I wasn't a guy, and the moment they opened it up, I jumped at it because I don't like being told that I can't do something for that very reason. But I've been on numerous deployments and in various areas where I'm one of few, if not the only female, and so this was nothing compared. I mean, it was fun. It's fun to get be a part of it. It's fun to go on deployment still and have fun with it, and to be amongst the first and some of the best and brightest that we have sitting here is just an honor. So that was one of the big things, was the honor of being that was something that was very much a part of why I chose to do it.
Anyone else want to chime in?
Ms. Martindale? Ma'am. Ensign Martindale, USS Maine Gold. I actually rode on USS Miami on a midshipman cruise, and it was a little over 24 hours, and the experience in those 24 hours alone showed me what a unique community the submarine community is. The camaraderie, the commitment, and the closeness, both physical and emotional, is particularly unique to the community. And after a 24-hour ride, and I was able to be on the con during Angles and Dangles under the supervision of some of the officers, I knew immediately that this is a unique experience, and it was definitely something I wanted to pursue. And I was lucky enough a year and a half later to actually walk down that path.
I'll go. Lieutenant Lorenz again from the USS Wyoming Blue. My first tour as a supply officer was on a submarine tender, actually. So we go around and we fix submarines that are in need out in the ocean. So that was my first exposure to submarines. And helping out the supply officers that were there, and myself being a supply officer on the submarine support ship, I was like, hey, this is really cool, and it's something that I could, you know I could definitely do this job. It looks exciting, you know, and if the opportunity ever opened up, I would, like Lieutenant Dreamin said, you know, we're all for it, and there it was. So we definitely definitely took advantage of that, and it's been really exciting so far, and yeah, we just hope it continues to open up to everyone else.
All right, we have time for maybe one last question before we break out to one-on-one sessions. If we can also let the Admiral continue on his schedule, as you guys can imagine, he's very busy. And thank you.
I have one.
Yep.
Go ahead.
Sorry, this is Jen Steele again from the San Diego Union Tribune. I wonder if any of the female officers there who are serving on subs have any thoughts on what it would be like to serve on a fast attack, which is much smaller.
I took a tour when our Lieutenant Britta Christensen, USS Ohio Gold, we're forward deployed out of Guam, the Ohio is, so we're physically stationed in Washington State, but we fly out to Guam, and there's three fast attack submarines out there, so one of their supply officers came over to us and they needed some help, so I went over to the Houston, I believe, over there to walk around and take a tour, and it is super small. So it's crazy, like, I don't know how the submariners on the fast attacks do it. God bless them for it, but I'll stay on my SSGN.
But, okay, one other thing, though. This is Lieutenant Esch, also USS Ohio Blue. The SSGN, which we're both on, is really the best of both worlds because you get to do more of the fast attack mission with the more space. So that really is awesome, and I'm really happy to be on the SSGN. But on the same side, the fast attack mission is really awesome, and that's a big reason why I think a lot of us join the submarine community, is to go out there and like do that work that is just like all of the history and the lore of the submarine community really comes back to those really awesome missions that the fast attacks do. So if it were to be open, I think that there are some of us that would probably be willing to serve on them despite the tight quarters. And also, back to that last question, that's kind of why I joined the submarine community, and the missions that they do and the tight quarters, it really comes down to the people that you serve with. And that kind of environment that we go into as submariners, it develops that esprit de corps that is really unique. And yes, we're sitting here at this table as submarine officers, yet unqualified, but it really goes back to the people that have gotten us here, which is the crew, and all those people that have spent years and years of service on submarines, learning the ins and outs of how to keep us safe and how to do those missions, and none of us would be here without them, and I think that that holds true for fast attack also, so.
All right, Admiral, sir, I'll like to turn it over to you, just if you have any last parting shot, and then we'll break off into our breakout session, sir, if that's okay.
Sure, happy to close up. First, I want to thank all of the submariners. I think that hopefully the reporters got to see exactly what I was talking about when I was talking about the best and brightest and most diverse that the nation has to offer. Really, you know, a jewel in our strategic crown as a nation, every one of them. And so, you know, my heart kind of burst with pride just sitting here with my microphone muted and listening to the Q&A go back and forth. And so so that, you know, kind of mission accomplished if we got that communicated across. I'll tell you that every mission that every submarine conducts today is super important, whether you're on a fast attack or an SSGN or an SSBN. That strategic deterrent mission is vitally important to the security of the United States and has to be executed with a tremendous amount of professionalism and precision. And so every one of those missions is really very, very important to the nation. And finally, I want to just express my gratitude to all of the reporters and the representatives of the media who came and joined us today. Again, my thanks on the eve of a long weekend for coming and spending some time with us. Hopefully that it was worth all of your time. And if we can ever kind of circle back and spend some time together, I'm happy to do that. And then just in closing, I ask that we kind of keep the whole team up on the USS Miami in our thoughts as they kind of, you know, recover from this fire that they had last night. That's all I've got to say.
Okay, thank you, Admiral. Thank you to everyone who joined us on the call in line. We can certainly talk after this and make sure all your questions were answered. If anyone has any follow-ups, you know, please see me or any of the other public affairs officers who are here. We're happy to help facilitate that. And with that, Admiral, we'll go ahead and get you on your way for the rest of the day, sir. Okay, so what we're going to do now is we're going to break up for our individual one-on-one sessions. There are signs up on the wall, and there's enough